Ted Cruz's chief of staff. The Hill newspaper branded Paul as the agitator-in-chief. Paul also helped found the House Conservatives Fund, the PAC aimed at electing conservatives to the U.S. House of Representatives. He continues to serve on the board of directors of the Duke University Alumni Association and was recently appointed to the board executive committee. Paul regularly addresses political conferences and meetings and has made dozens of TV and radio talk show appearances. He and his wife Maxine are very proud parents of one daughter and one son. And now welcome Paul Teller.
Thank you. Hey, morning. Are we on? Are we good? Okay. Really great to be here. Young Americans Foundation, as the staff backstage can tell you and Kyle can tell you, is an organization I am constantly speaking to, connecting with, led by Ron Robinson and others. It really is a fantastic organization. So if this is your first experience with YAF, you're very lucky and be very proud. And it's an organization you're going to be closely aligned with, I think, for years to come. I'll try to be relatively short, yet give you some information that I think helps. I wanted to come here today to tell you that, well, let's put it this way. You're all a bunch of troublemakers, right? That's why you're kind of in the conservative movement. It's why you're here. It's why you're spending a summer week in Washington, D.C., when you could be on the beach. You could be doing a lot more summery type things, but you're here because you're a bunch of rebel rousers. You're a bunch of troublemakers. I think that's why they wanted me to start you off this morning, right? So I'm here to tell you, and I'll give you a little bit of detail in a moment, that you're going to meet with very much success. A lot of folks you'll come across in life will tell you that if you're a troublemaker in, you know, the conservative movement, in the Republican Party, at your school, you know, you're going to have a hard path. It's going to be rocky. Maybe not everyone's going to like you. Your career, you know, it's not going to be as successful. Frankly, congressmen even hear this story too. When new congressmen come to town, they're immediately told by the Republican establishment, just kind of get along, go along, don't rock the boat too much. That'll be much easier for you. Well, I just wanted to bring a message to you this morning that you can rock the boat, you can be the agitator, as was said in the intro, and have some success. And so let me give you a little more color to the bio of my story that Kyle was mentioning. And again, this will all be relevant. So a few inflection points in my life to demonstrate what I'm talking about. One is seventh grade that I can remember. Long Island, New York, a town called Plainview. I don't know if there's any New Yorkers here, but it's Nassau County. It's the first county out from New York City. And although I grew up with a very, very liberal mom, and a moderate, slightly right of center dad who's unfortunately liberal now, but at the time was a little bit right of center. He doesn't have me pushing back against mom, so you know he's moved all the way to the left. But at the time he was moderate. Somehow raised this radical conservative. How do we know this? Because in seventh grade, we did this political simulation. The whole grade got together, answered all these questions. Pretty sophisticated kind of thing for a public school in seventh grade. Based on the answers to the questions, they grouped us into these ideological kind of sections. And it wasn't just randomly done. It was based on your answers, and it was a normal curve. So a few people were radicals on the way left. A little bit more were liberals. The bulk of the people, bulk of seventh grade, were moderates. A little fewer were conservatives. And I was in like the far right wing tail, like a time they called reactionary. I don't even know if they use that word anymore. And this is seventh grade, coming out of a family that shouldn't have created this radical conservative. So right off the bat, I was this kind of nut job, problem causer, right-wing radical. That continued at Duke University in undergrad. And for me, and I don't know if you guys feel this way, everyone kind of has their different ways of agitating, of sticking up for their conservative principles. Some folks do it, you know, with a, you know, megaphone outside the student center. That wasn't quite me. I was not that loud at that time. That wasn't me at the time. What was me was being a classroom agitator. I loved being that pain in the butt in the classroom to the professor. You guys know what I'm talking about. When a professor just says something liberal as if it's totally fact, it's given, it's understood. Of course, everybody feels that way. And if there's just silence, well, then the professor is kind of proven right, you know, and you have to sit there and stew, and maybe the other liberal students are shaking their head. Yeah, that's right. I guess that's the truth, and maybe it's going to even show up on the test. I was that student that would raise my hand and be like, what are you talking about? Or I totally disagree. Challenging the assumptions of the left, because they just have these baseline assumptions of the way life is. Like, of course it's this way, of course it's that way. Challenge that. So I want to encourage you to continue to do the same. We'll talk more about that in a moment. But so that was kind of the next inflection point where, you know, I would just, you know, things like, I even remember, I was, besides poli sci, I loved art history at Duke University. I just remember there was this one time in art history when the professor put up some, it was like sound art. It wasn't even visual, it's just sounds. It's like people like banging on metal things and wood and listening to the different sounds. It was so atrociously horrible, and nobody would say anything. And again, I know this isn't political, but like, we all did these group presentations on this sound art, and everyone getting up there, so wonderful, and it means this, and interpret it this way. And it, well, I just got up there and started ripping on this sound art, and everyone, just to see everyone's face, the students, oh, you can't say that, you're gonna get a bad grade. And it's just, it's ridiculous. I actually wind up getting an A in the class, because if you give reasoned, logical perspectives and thoughts on what you're saying, and backing up your agitation with facts, generally, professors and other students will respect you. I also, it was fun, I took a Nazi history class, and I remember being the guy to raise my hand and just say, you know, if Jews and others in Germany just had guns, we wouldn't have had the Holocaust. And it was easier for me to say that as a Jewish guy a little bit. You know, you get a little more leverage to say things like that. But still, again, the freak out sessions. What? Guns? You know, so it's amazing how just pushing back in the classroom will help. And again, we'll get back to that in a little bit. Another inflection point, after college, I didn't want to stop with that. I was at the College Republican National Committee, you know, as Kyle mentioned before. The reason that was controversial, we were kind of a band of rebels within the Republican Party at the time. At the time, I don't think it's set up this way anymore, but the CRNC is actually an entity, or was an entity within the RNC, within the Republican National Committee. We got our offices from them, our funding, and so you were kind of beholden to them a little bit. Well, that, of course, created a problem when we decided to criticize fellow Republicans for not being conservative. We felt like you should put principle before party. That was not the greatest way to win friends in the Republican National Committee. So eventually, they kicked us out of our offices, they defunded us, literally like sent us like fleeing into the woods of Virginia. We, at the time, a gentleman by the name of Howard Phillips, who was kind of a giant in the conservative movement at the time, ran a group called the Conservative Caucus. He like took us under his wing. He said, fine, I'll let the College Republican National Committee have offices. But just imagine that, though, that the Republican National Committee boots out the College Republican National Committee from its offices, cut its phone lines, cut its funding, and stuff like that, all for saying we should be conservatives first, Republicans second. So, okay, so another inflection point, excuse me, is the Republican Study Committee. And that's a caucus that exists to this day, but its brand has changed a little bit. Back when I started working for it, 2001, 2002, and then on, it was really the rebel rouser caucus in the U.S. House of Representatives. It was where the kind of, you know, if in a way you could call them backbencher House members, got together to kind of collaborate and aggregate their conservative action, their conservative ideas, push for conservative solutions, pull the party to the right, force conservative solutions into law, just basically be good conservatives. But they were very much aimed at agitating against Republicans. In other words, by pulling the party to the right, that often means telling the party, hey, this bill stinks, or that budget is too liberal, or Mr. George W. Bush, who was the president at the time, your budget grows government. We're supposed to be shrinking government. Or Republican leadership, we're not supposed to be spending down the surplus. Let's give it back to the taxpayers, things like that. So that got us constantly into trouble. One example was actually when there was a the chairman of the RSC was a name you are probably familiar with now, Mike Pence of Indiana. He was the chairman. He was the third chairman I worked for. And we did this thing called Operation Offset, which basically was this big RSC-wide effort to offset federal spending that was being sent willy-nilly down to the Gulf Coast in the wake of Hurricane Katrina. Terrible disaster, terrible devastation. And I think everyone was saying, we as a society, we as a federal government are happy to help out. But since it's emergency spending, unplanned for, let's offset it with reductions in lower priority spending. And there's plenty of that in the federal government. Well, believe it or not, that was this radical notion. We're going to offset emergency spending. How could you be so insensitive? People are dying. They lost their homes. Entire communities are flooded. How could we offset? Our response was just the opposite. How could we not offset? I mean, it's already a natural disaster tragedy. Now we're going to turn it into a fiscal tragedy as well by adding $60 billion to the nation's debt that has to be paid back with interest down the road. So we had this whole big rally, if you will, with members of Congress and staff and outside groups and activists and young folks and people holding signs, people bust in from everywhere. We had this big, big event, and it is aimed, again, at our own leadership, our own Republican leadership, saying, please listen to us. We tried to work behind the scenes. It wasn't working behind the scenes, so we took it public and we took it to the press. And in the end, we wound up getting some cuts. It wasn't fully offset, but we did get some spending reductions. So you know, that was an example of where some kind of in-your-face, thumbing your eye at our own leadership did win some success for the American people. So other examples that the RSC was, and again, obviously we're skipping years here, and there's plenty in every single year, but in the interest of brevity, just a few highlights. 2011, Tea Party wave of congressmen come in, and you may remember the hot issue at the time was the debt ceiling. Maybe you don't remember, you're a little bit young, but just in case you do remember, it was the debt ceiling. Should we raise the debt ceiling? We're coming up against it. There were lots of folks who said, raise it automatically, no questions asked, we have to raise it, we don't want to default, was the argument. Folks on the other side were, never raise it, no matter what, don't raise it, just, you know, we'll have to cut spending, maybe we'll go into default, who knows, don't raise it. I would say, though, the vast majority of members of Congress, including a lot of good hardcore conservatives, were saying, look, we don't want to raise the debt ceiling, but we will in exchange for some fiscal discipline. And we came up with what we called then cut, cap, and balance. Immediate spending cuts of $100 billion off the current fiscal year, spending caps going forward to get some fiscal discipline going forward, and a balanced budget amendment passed through Congress and sent out to the states. So basically, fine, we'll give you your debt ceiling, but in exchange for current and future fiscal discipline. Nothing totally radical, but somehow that was taken as radical. So radical that people went after our chairman. At the time, it was Jim Jordan of Ohio. You may know that name. They came after me personally. I was a staffer at the time. And they came after another staffer called Wes Goodman, who's actually running for the state senate in Ohio, someone you actually should look into. Literally, can you imagine? There were literally Republican congressmen coming after staffers for working to provide a solution for the debt ceiling. Why? Because we weren't just bowing down to the Republican leadership's version of raising the debt ceiling immediately, and down the road, maybe kind of, sort of, we'll get to some spending cuts. Well, we all know from anyone who's followed politics for more than 5 minutes, when there's, you know, a debt ceiling increase now and promises of spending cuts down the road, the spending cuts never, ever happen. It's the same way that right now, there's often deals of, we'll do spending increases now, and the tax cuts will come down the road. Well, of course, the tax relief or the automatic spending cuts never, ever happen. They're always put off. So we had a lot of fun doing cut, cap, and balance. But again, folks were coming after us. There were articles in the paper saying that I should be fired. There were leaks from private emails of, you know, personal folks just kind of emailing each other. All of a sudden, those found their way into the press. I mean, it was a really heightened time. But I think in the end, again, we met with some success because it yielded what was called the Budget Control Act. Not a perfect piece of legislation, but it did get some immediate spending cuts and some spending discipline going forward. So that was another example of kind of conservative agitation within the family yielding some success. Well, I guess one real big inflection point worth pointing out, and I demonstrate this, I bring this up to show that it is possible to still live. December 2013, I was fired from my job at the Republican Study Committee. No warning, no, I don't know what the word is, but anyway, no, there was no buildup to it. It just was, I was, you know, not in sync with the way the caucus was starting to go. It was becoming less of an agitator type caucus. I was not becoming less of an agitator staffer, and so it didn't match up. So I was tossed out the door, and the good news was by then I had already connected with a gentleman by the name of Ted Cruz. You may have heard the name. And he said, well, okay, a troublemaker type guy who gets tossed out of the conservative caucus for being too conservative, that's my kind of guy. He needed a deputy chief at the time. He was creating a slot because the chief of staff was going back and forth between Texas and DC. He wanted someone on a senior leadership level in the DC office full time. So brought me on as deputy chief. A few months later, elevated me to chief. And one of the things I think we're most proud of within the Ted Cruz operation on the official side, and there's plenty to be proud of, but one thing in the theme of what we've been talking about this morning, agitation and sticking to your principles, is I was one of the ones most pushing Senator Cruz to call out Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell for telling a lie about the export-import bank situation. I'm not sure if this is something you followed. And for those of you who haven't followed it, it's a little detailed, but basically, there's this thing called the Export-Import Bank, which is this federal bank that takes taxpayer dollars or leverages taxpayer assets and makes loans or loan guarantees to foreign companies or foreign countries to buy certain favored American products. It's the typical kind of, cronyist type of taxpayer-funded setup that usually hurts the taxpayer, or at least puts them on the hook, all to help certain favored big companies generally. It's a very long story short, but there had been a deal regarding reauthorizing this Export-Import Bank in exchange for votes for Trade Promotion Authority, which helps make it easier for trade deals to go through Congress. Again, gory details we can get into another time, but basically there was a deal made in exchange. Senator McConnell said, no, there wasn't. A lot of folks in the conservative movement, including us and the Cruz staff, saying, yes, there clearly was, based on these points of evidence. Senator Cruz, and I'm not speaking behind his back, he said this on the Senate floor, didn't necessarily believe us at first. No, that can't be. How can that be? Well, anyway, it was discovered that there absolutely was a deal, and that's when Senator Cruz kind of went to the Senate floor with his famous "you lie" speech, if you will. And, he actually didn't really want to do that. It wasn't something he got pleasure out of, but it was amazing when Republican establishment folks were working against the conservative movement, which had been so pushing hard to stop the Export-Import Bank. So again, that's just one example in the Ted Cruz Senate office of some of this agitation. So why do I bring all this up? It's not because you're so interested in hearing my story. It's not that great of a story. But I bring it up to hopefully give maybe some inspiration that you can agitate, you can be a troublemaker, you can get in trouble, you could be in the press with your friends and allies coming after you. You can get fired. You can literally get fired from a longtime job. When I was fired, I had been at the Republican Study Committee for almost 13 years under 7 different chairmen. So this was a long time thing, but totally fine. We as conservatives don't believe you have a right to a government job, so I had every right to be tossed out if I was no longer a fit. But it shows that you can get back up again. A month later, I was working for soon-to-be presidential candidate Ted Cruz. And so I would encourage you to take that back to your campuses this fall. Take that attitude and don't let the left get the best of you. Don't let them have their assumptions heard in class. I shouldn't say that. Yes, they can be heard. They should always be challenged. Never let them go unchallenged. Doesn't have to be mean either. In fact, I would encourage you to be calm, be polite, smile. They hate when conservatives smile. Right, Kyle, we were talking about this last time. Drives them absolutely bonkers. If you're just polite and calm and you're smiling. And here's the thing that I would also advise is ask them questions. Make them justify what they're saying. Because if you think about it, I don't know if any of you watched some of the Democrat convention last night. It's one slogan after another. Everything thing they say fits on a bumper sticker. And in a way, God bless them, right? I frankly wish conservatives had more that fit on a bumper sticker, right? A lot of times our positions take 47 paragraphs to explain, but That's why, by the way, when we had that cut cap and balance thing on the debt ceiling, that was so great. We finally had a bumper sticker. It was so great. But they have all they have is bumper stickers. And if they're not challenged on their bumper stickers to explain what they mean, they get to kind of be right. They get to kind of live on. So just ask them very simple, polite questions. You know, like for example, last night they were talking about the minimum wage. So if you go back to campus and someone says, you know, there needs to be a $15 an hour minimum wage. You know, it's a livable wage, blah, 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 blah. Instead of like giving 46 points in contrast to that, instead of starting to roll off some data. See, that's the thing too. And I'm not saying you do this and I don't do this. I do this all the time. I hate that I do it. You start talking about data. Well, the facts show that da-da-da-da, studies show blah, blah, blah. And people are asleep by the time you're in your third syllable. Instead, put it on them to have to come up with the data. Because here's the secret. They don't have any data. They have nothing. You know, so maybe just say to your fellow comrade who says, you know, we should have a $15 minimum wage. So you'd be in favor of the $15 minimum wage even if it put some young people out of work? Question mark, and then just stop. And see, that's another thing I have trouble doing too. I don't know if you guys feel the same way. Asking a question and then shutting up and letting them provide the answer. Let the teacher or let the liberal students that you're arguing with, let them talk. Don't fill it in for them. Don't say, well, you must mean da-da-da. Don't give the answer. Don't rephrase the question. Ask the question and then just, you know, just like, you know, wait for the answer. A lot of times you'll get no answer or you'll get the, I don't know. It's right. I mean, it's amazing. They really, a lot of times, can't back up their own emotion-driven political slogans. Sometimes even just asking them to define something is great too. How would you define that? What do you mean by fairness? And again, zip. What do you mean by fairness? And then just stop and let them see what they say. Admit, they're going to start, well, you know, or actually, this is what Bernie Sanders is talking about. You know, the wealthy need to earn less, and we need to have more income equality. I totally hear you, but how would you define income equality? What's a good level of equality for you? Zip. And you'll see they have either no answer, which is the ideal, or their answer is so ridiculous. Well, I think if everyone earns $75,000 a year, you know, that's fine. Why $75,000 a year? Zip. Yeah. And just, you're going to see, it's so satisfying. It's remarkably awesome. Because, again, they don't have the answer. So I just wanted to encourage you, be confident in your positions. They're right. They're backed up by history and the Constitution. You have organizations like Young America's Foundation who can get you the data. Let's face it, there are times you do need the data. Let's say you're writing a paper or you're in debate club and you actually need some data. You can't just smile and nod. Use the conservative movement organizations as a whole network of them to get that information. Heritage Foundation, for example, can practically get you any number on any issue. Come through folks like me. I mean, and I'll give you my email address at the end, but we're happy if we can't get you an answer. You know, I've spent a lifetime, you know, being connected throughout the conservative movement. I'll plug you into someone who can get you the answer or the best argument, things like that. So be confident in your principles. Be calm. Don't freak out. Let them freak out. Smile. Let them get angry. And they will. And it's deeply, deeply satisfying. So anyway, with that, why don't I stop, open it up to Q&A. I will say, and this is, I guess, maybe one piece of bad news for the room. I do have to respectfully dodge any campaign-related questions. I work in the Senate staff. Campaign questions would go to campaign-related staff. So I know that kind of stinks because I know some of the most exciting stuff related to Ted Cruz right now has to do with the campaign. But if I could artfully dodge those questions, that would be that we appreciate it. But anyway, happy to talk about any of these things or any other topics, whatever looks good that's not campaign related. Okay, thanks.
Pretty much the summary of what you're saying of how to, you know,
oh, Mike. Okay, there we. I guess there. There we go. So we'll go to this one, and we'll get you next by the time you get over there. Yes, sir.
I'm Josh, and I'm from the University of the Great State of Tennessee. And I just wanted to ask, what was Ted Cruz like in person? What were like the best parts of his personality?
No, absolutely. You know what's funny is some of the things that you've seen, and some of this was in a campaign setting, but you know, when he recited lines from The Princess Bride or any of those kind of pop culture-y moments, those are actually totally genuine. I mean, as a staff, the reason we thought that was so hilarious is because he did that stuff like behind closed doors well before it was out in the public. Because when that came out, people emailed like, ha ha, you know, he's doing that just for the campaign, just to look cool. I got to tell you, when we have staff meetings in our Senate office, like, he'll cut us off mid-sentence because he just thought of a Simpsons episode that relates to what we're talking about. He goes to his computer, he pulls up the Simpsons episode, and we like watch 3 minutes of it in the middle of a staff meeting. And then sometimes we're like, okay, can we get back to the staff meeting now? Like, you know, Princess Bride, he's always throwing out lines from the Princess Bride. He's got a signed picture of, I'm forgetting the name of the character, but just kind of the main character with the bandana in the movie. Signed picture of him hanging in his Senate office. So, I mean, it actually is genuine and real. He's hilarious to work with, constantly cracking, you know, little jokes and stuff like that, but hard charging. I don't want to, you know, sugarcoat it either. When we're sitting in a policy meeting, it's serious stuff. I mean, he wants to know the pros and cons of every issue or bill that we're presenting him. He actually hates if we just present him one side. Like, even if we as a staff say, okay, we really need you to introduce this bill, here are the 10 reasons why you should, and then we just stop. Well, he'll be like, okay, now give me some reasons why I shouldn't introduce this bill, or who's going to be angry at me if I introduce this bill, or who else would introduce this bill that if I introduce it, you know, they'll feel that I stole their thunder. He wants to know the other side, or what's the pros and cons, who's against, who's for. And that's great, and frankly, and that's his lawyerly training and his prosecutor by training. I'm not a lawyer, so I don't naturally think that way. Usually if I'm trying to convince someone of anything, you present one side, right? You just kind of, here are the facts over here. He really wants both sides, so it's a real, it's kind of a real pleasure to, you know, to work with him that way, so cool.
Thanks.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir, sorry about the delay.
Do you mind if I ask two questions, or just one?
Yep, sure, no, let's,
okay,
as long as no one else minds.
The first question is, so the summary of your speech is that when we're debating the left, we're just trying to catch them to see if they can make a gaffe or put their foot in their mouth, like when you talked about a Bernie Sanders when they answered the question, define income inequality, or what do you mean by fairness?
Yeah, in other words, like, you'd be amazed how many just terms they throw out, assuming that we know what that means, right? Fairness, of course, means everybody is equal. But let them explain that. And a lot of times when you hear them explain it, they sound so, frankly, uninformed, uneducated, inconsistent, or just seeing them having trouble get the words out is miraculous and awesome. So yeah, I would absolutely do that.
And the other question, and I do not mean this in any disrespect towards Ted Cruz. I voted for him. That was the first vote I ever casted in my life on Super Tuesday in Georgia. However,
appreciate it.
I hear students who say that Ted Cruz, they don't like him because, you know, he's mean and that he doesn't get along and that he's abrasive. Is that necessarily true that he's mean, or is he just, you know, he just has this something in him that makes him want to fight over and over again for conservatives?
No, absolutely. Great point. He's definitely not mean. And again, this is from being on the inside with him for several years now. In fact, I can't think of one mean thing he's ever said. And I can think of other congressmen I've worked for who have said mean things. I won't name any names, but folks who, you know, do say things where it's like, ooh, boss, that was a little mean there. You know, he's never said a mean thing. When a lot of folks accuse him of being mean, it comes out of two things. It comes, one, out of just being hard charging, right? When you're on the Senate floor saying, I can't believe we're doing this, we really should be doing that, we're violating our principles, we're not doing what we said we would do, we should tell the truth. That could to some folks come across as, you know, mean, whatever. But number two, let's face it, he also, I don't know how familiar you guys are with the Wizard of Oz movie, but Ted Cruz pulls the curtain back on the wizard a lot of times, right? Like it's real easy to kind of, I don't mean this in as bad as it's gonna sound, but it's easy to fool the American people in Washington because there's so many little intricacies of parliamentary procedure and little things that go on that congressmen sometimes can make it look like you're doing something when you're really not. Let me just give you a perfect example of what I mean. It goes back to the debt ceiling, not the one from 2011, but this is from 2014 maybe or something like that. I have to look back. But where senators literally wanted to look like they were opposing a debt ceiling increase, all the while they were voting to advance a debt ceiling increase through the Senate. You know what I mean? So it's kind of like they quietly vote to move that legislation along. You know, it's called cloture in the Senate. Knowing that kind of the press and Joe America isn't quite following the procedural votes leading up to it. But then when you get to the final passage of the debt ceiling bill, then they, I vote no, you know, because at that point, they knew there would be enough votes for it to pass. Democrats plus some Republicans were enough to pass it. So it allows more Republicans to go up and say, I vote against this bill, even though just before, like literally like the day before, they voted to advance the bill, to move it along in the process. And it's like, wait a minute. If you're really against the debt ceiling increase, you should have voted to stop it moving in the process, right? So there's a lot of that. Ted Cruz points out those facts a lot in public. And so some folks, therefore, in Washington, he's mean. He's pointing out the fact that we're, you know, fooling the American public. So I think that's where some of it comes from as well. No, thank you. Appreciate it. Other, yeah?
Yes. Hearing your story about your political career, what are you going to do next?
Good question. Can't reveal too many details, but very soon something will roll out that I think you'll like, and I'm going to move over to that entity. I'm going to leave the Senate office, and I'm going over to this this basically nonprofit organization that's going to be founded based on the Ted Cruz grassroots network that was created, 2.3 million people during the campaign, voters, donors, volunteers, things along those lines. We want to work to make sure that network is kept fresh and educated and agitated and informed and motivated and all that stuff. It's not something Ted Cruz can control. There's legal rules that say he can't be the head of it, but it will be based off of the network that was built from the Ted Cruz world. We'll have Ted Cruz-related staffers working it, and so it'll help continue to promote conservative solutions and ideas and advocate for them in a kind of a grassroots context nationwide. So that's the next step for me, and coming pretty soon. And again, more details will roll out soon, and we can get those to you and the whole conservative movement. But that's a little preview.
And by the way, the phrase you were looking for earlier was 2 weeks' notice.
2 weeks' notice? Well, yes, correct. Exactly. Sounds good.
Hi, my name is Joe Ballard from the University of Alabama. First off, thank you for speaking to us this morning. That was fantastic.
No, thanks for being here.
My question is this. In recent years, and especially during this election, there seems to be a polarization on both sides of the aisle with people reaching farther left and farther right. Mm. I was wondering if you could comment on this and maybe allude to where you think they might be coming from.
Yeah, great question. I think that's right. In terms of where some of this polarization is coming from, because you're right, you do see a relatively disappearing class of moderates, certainly the Democrat Party. That's real easy.
Yeah.
Republicans, there's still a decent number of moderates left, but maybe it's on the down. If you were to graph it, it's probably decreasing. I think some of it might come, I know this is kind of a boring academic answer, but it might just come from congressional redistricting. There's a lot of, in the last few cycles of redistricting, the congressional districts have all been made more ideologically pure in order to keep incumbents safe. Easiest way to keep incumbents safe, give them a more ideologically pure district, right? Give a Democrat more Democrats in their district, give a Republican more Republicans in their district. So each district itself is a little more polarized. Therefore, they elect a little more pure congressmen, either hard left or hard right, whatever that means, but you know what I'm talking about. More liberal, more conservative. And therefore, you get more of those folks and fewer moderates in Congress. I'm guessing. That's obviously something that could be, actually researched. But that's top of my head. I think that's where some of it is coming from. So,
thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Let's see. Yeah.
Hi, my name's Danielle Fife. I attend Patrick Henry College. And
excellent.
To move a little way, bit away from the politics of it, you seem to have a bit of a unique story because you have a history of being ostracized by the Republican Party and by your fellow conservatives. And in the same way, I have a bit of a unique story too, because I attend a conservative college and find that the biggest roadblock that I run into is conservatives who may care about the issues and may be passionate about conservative values, but refuse to actually be active or do anything about it. And I'm kind of here this week looking for the tools maybe to fire them up and get them involved. Do you have any advice for encouraging fellow conservatives to be active and to get involved.
That's a really great point. And you're right that there could be apathy when there's a lot of folks around you who agree. I've even found that just even in some of my, you know, social circles that, you know, if you stay too insular, if in other words, the only people you're talking to are fellow conservatives, you're not sharpening your pencil as much. Like you said, you don't feel the need to get active as much. You don't even feel the need to defend your point as much, as opposed to if you're, you know, at a liberal school like Duke University, where you're constantly bombarded by that group in a, you know, liberal New York family, a lot of liberal friends. So everything you say gets challenged. You know, you can't breathe at the Thanksgiving Day table without like someone saying, "How could you possibly?" Every sentence starts with "How could you?" Right? I don't know if you guys have experienced that in your lives. How could you? Fill in the blank. So yeah, I totally hear you. In terms of how to motivate folks, I mean, it is tough. I think maybe the only way to help motivate those folks is maybe expose them to fellow conservatives who themselves are surrounded by liberals and what they're up against. And, you know, try to inspire them that way, that we can't be apathetic sitting here at Patrick Henry College when conservatives at this school and this school and this school and this school are under constant attack. They need our help too. And if we get apathetic here, you know, that could spread. I mean, that would be just my advice, is to kind of expose them to folks who are battling every day, who they can't say a single sentence that's not challenged in some way by the administration, by teachers, by friends, by parents, you know, et cetera. So give that a shot. But I'd love to be in touch offline further just to help think that through more, because that's a great challenge I'd love to help with. So appreciate it. Yeah.
How's it going? My name is Will Nardi from Roger Williams University. And I really liked what you were saying during your speech about being an agitator in class. I mean, that's what I like to do, with call out my professors. But I just wanted to hear from you, because I know why I do it, but why do you think it's important to be a rabble-rouser?
Well, that's a good question. And by the way, I should point out, you know, I'm assuming just everyone by nature who's here has a little bit of rabble-rousing. But if you're sitting there saying, "Oh, well, actually, I don't know what he's talking about. I don't feel that way. I'm not quite that way," that's totally fine. Not everybody needs to be like the agitator, the rebel rouser to have a successful political career. Just the opposite. There are people who do fail at that too. I just wanted to point out that if you are that way, you can succeed. It's not automatic failure that like some people will tell you. But I think the reason I found it important, some of it is just personality, right? Sometimes you're just inborn with the need to push, right, and to argue and to stand up for what you believe. But some of it is, you know, if you do have beliefs and values, and we do believe in the Constitution, limited government, and, you know, God-given rights, those things unfortunately don't kind of present themselves. They don't just bring themselves to life. They have to be fought for by human beings. In fact, most of the history of humanity is people not living under those values and those principles. We're experiencing today, ISIS and other enemies would do anything they can to overturn those values and to overturn those who live by those values. So I think it's important to be that agitator and that rebel rouser, if you will, so that it's not, you're not, because if you're silent, you're yielding to what the other folks are saying. You're, even if not directly, at least indirectly, you're basically sending them a message that, well, because I'm not challenging you, I'm accepting what you're saying, effectively. Doesn't mean every single sentence that every liberal says, you have to start this big fight. Of course not. Pick and choose your battles where the battlefield is most favorable to you, if you can. But frankly, even if not, if you're in some seminar at school, 20 people and 19 are liberals and you're the one conservative, you know, go for it. Like I said, if you're doing it polite, calm, confident, smiling, asking questions, making them defend themselves, I think that's not only justified, but desirable. And frankly, and this is another word you could use, bring into your lexicon, use the word diversity a lot. Drives them absolutely bonkers. In other words, in that little example, 19 liberals, one conservative. Guys, I just wanted to bring a diverse opinion to the class here. Or, you know, hey, I just heard three speakers say blah, 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 blah. I want, you know, I think they could actually use a little diversity here. It drives them. I mean, literally watch the smoke fly right out of their ears. It's fantastic, because it's, you know, anytime you could turn their language back on them, it's fantastic. And a lot of those folks don't actually want diversity. They'll say it, But they really don't want intellectual diversity, academic diversity. They don't want to hear the different opinions. They a lot of times can't stand it. Ah, I don't want to hear it. Ah, go away. Challenge that because it deserves to be challenged. You know. So.
Thank you so
cool.
much.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is John Clayton from Texas A&M University.
Excellent.
Actually from Houston, Texas. Ted's
there you go.
Town there.
There you go. Love it.
And I was wondering, like, I know being a conservative is all about standing up for your principles and kind of not breaking into the other pressures, but Washington is also a lot of compromise, and
yep.
not everyone can have 100% of what they want. So as conservatives, how do we find that middle ground where we don't give in on our principles and we stand for, like, what we believe in, but we also understand the need to, like, keep the country moving forward and passing laws? Like
fantastic question. Absolutely great question. Because it's true. Anyone who tells you, you know, to be a true conservative means you fight for 100% of what you want and you accept nothing less than 100%, they're selling you a bill of goods, right? Because truthfully, how could that ever happen in any sort of democratic system with a House, with a Senate, with a presidency, and within the House and Senate, there's so many different voices, there's no way you're ever gonna get 100%. Doesn't mean you don't articulate what your ideal vision is, but then realize, yeah, if we can take, you know, a significant step in the right direction, in the direction that you wanna go, that's some progress. 'Cause also realize, the other side's coming at you with the same thing. In other words, if you've got liberals coming to the negotiating table saying they need 100%, conservatives come and say they need 100%, well, you're gonna get zero. So I totally agree that we shouldn't go in with that assumption. What you can do is, frankly, going back to the 2011 debt ceiling example I gave before, cut, cap, and balance. Perfect example of how conservatives were advancing a conservative agenda, pretty significant conservative agenda, but still within the context of compromise, meaning conservatives said, fine, we'll raise the debt ceiling. We don't really want to, but we will in exchange for immediate cuts, spending caps going forward, a balanced budget going out to the states. Because the conservative logic at the time was, yeah, we don't really want to raise the debt ceiling, but again, there's folks over there demanding it, won't take anything less than that. So let's see what we can get for it. Maybe we can get some spending discipline that, if designed properly, will reduce the need to even have to raise the debt ceiling down the line. You know, it'll reduce spending, balance the budget. And so we won't even have these discussions later because there won't be a debt ceiling that needs raising. So that's a way to look at it too, is what can I get now that sets me up for even more success later? It's almost like, you know, let's plant the seed now. It doesn't look like much, it's sitting in the soil, kind of dormant, but you know, it's gonna start to peek up above the soil, a couple leaves, later on, a few flowers. That kind of thing. So the more you can do those kind of things, the better. So yeah, appreciate it. Yes, sir.
Trevor Wieger, University of Nebraska, Kearney. First off, just thanks for coming to speak to us
today.
No,
thank you.
I guess, long story short, so last year in a political science class, I learned that the right and left are becoming more polarized, but that it's the right that's moving way farther to the right, basically like the left are the ones that are more calm, stable.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
So I guess from my perspective, you know, it seems like guys like Ted Cruz, the more conservative ones, are the ones in the minority. The Republican establishment is usually winning out. While on the left, it seems like Bernie Sanders' quasi-Marxism is becoming more popular by the day. So I guess my
great
question
point.
Is, like, where do you stand and view this trend? And I guess, like, being on the inside of a Senate staffer, like, where do you see it moving forward in that perspective?
No, great, great point. Yeah, I think one trend, fact, whatever you want to say, that goes to what you're speaking is the leadership of the Democrat Party loves its base, right? If you think about it, right? When was the last time you heard Nancy Pelosi criticizing the liberal base, or vice versa? When was the liberal base at some rally booing its leadership? But I got to tell you, go to a lot of conservative rallies, Tea Party type rallies, and just say the word Mitch McConnell. Just don't even put it in a sentence. Mitch McConnell. Boo, you're going to hear it, right? I mean, like, John Boehner, and maybe not now because he's no longer Speaker, but back then, I mean, and the Republican leadership consistently feels at odds with its base, with its conservative base, that its conservative base is a problem, whereas, you know, Democrat leadership doesn't see its liberal base as a problem. How it got that way, that, again, takes some more research, more thought than we've got here on the stage. But I think that spawns a lot of what you're what you're talking about. And I think why there's maybe even more contention within the Republican Party, because you've got that gulf between leadership and its base, whereas on the Democrat side, leadership and their base are very much aligned ideologically. It doesn't mean they don't have different tactics here and there. I know there's differences between the Bernie Sanders and the Hillary Clinton people, but ideologically, they're really, really similar and working in the same way. Last point on that too, some of it also is media coverage, right? The media generally, I know there's exceptions, but generally foments this fact that the Republican Party is moving much more to the right. They have much more crazies. The left, the Democrat Party, sure, there's some liberals, but no, truthfully, they're much more mainstream, right? I mean, just the coverage of the Democrat convention so far has not pointed out some of the extreme things that are in their platform, whereas the media loved to point out the extreme things that were in our platform. And by extreme, they, of course, mean constitutionally based, first principles. But to them, that's how it's framed and stuff. So, cool.
Awesome. Thanks.
Yeah, no, thank you. Thank you. Yes, sir.
Hey, how you doing? My name's Darren England. I go to Virginia Tech. And my question is, how often do you see our politicians vote based on their own ideologies as opposed to just voting along party lines and to even fool their constituents, like you said, with a debt ceiling?
Yeah, absolutely. No, it's a mixture. I think, and I obviously don't have any sort of actual numbers off the top of my head, but it is a mixture. There's, and I know there's studies on voting behavior, but really just having worked for many members of Congress over the years, any given vote, one thing could be dominant in their decision making over another. In other words, in some vote, it's the constituents. There are definitely votes where Senator Cruz goes to the floor and he's voting for Texas. He's like, Texas really wants XYZ, I'm going to give it to them because it's around the whole state, it's key issue, that kind of thing. Other times he goes and maybe he's voting for the conservative movement. What's just the conservative right thing to do, no matter who else is angry at me. Other times, and I know this isn't what Joe America necessarily wishes it were this way, but sometimes it's how are my friends voting? Congressmen are also friends with each other. And they'll look up and see on the House, there's a big board of how everyone votes in real time. You can look up and be, so-and-so voted this way, so-and-so voted that way. Okay, I'll vote with him. There is a lot of that. In the Senate, it's not up on a board, but you can look on the list of who voted how. And how did that senator vote? I'm usually with him. I'll stick with that. It just varies. Obviously, staff are important too. They in most congressional offices, staff give a voting recommendation to every senator or member of Congress in advance of the vote. Sometimes they ignore staff. Sometimes they follow staff. It's a whole big mix of things. And then last point is sometimes members also just want to be consistent with how they were in the past, that they may not even be thinking too much about what's the immediate. It's like, well, how did I vote on that last year? Oh, it's pretty much the same bill. I was a yes last year. I'm a yes this year. Without looking at maybe there's a new context or maybe they did change Section 7 or whatever. So there's a whole variety of things that drive voting behaviors. I don't know how much, what the percentages are, but I can speak for Ted Cruz, who does vote very, very high percentage of the time on his beliefs, on his principles, his ideology, things along those lines. He's not one to just put his finger in the wind or just look at a list and be like, sure, I'll follow him. That's not quite him, So anyway.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Yeah, thanks. Nice, sir.
You talked a lot about both in your talk and in answering questions about the divide that's growing between the establishment and the base. And as a member of this kind of new right-wing shift in the Republican base, I suppose my question to people like Ted Cruz and strong conservatives like that is that, you have a great track record fighting for conservative principles fiscally, fighting for to not increase the debt ceiling and things like that. But when it comes to things which, in my opinion, matter a little bit more,
yep,
like guarding the border, constructing an actual border wall is called for in the law, preserving American jobs for American workers, and securing fair trade deals, these kind of things which are important to the lives of the American people.
Good point.
And social issues too, abortion and
yep, religious freedom.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And these kind of issues. You don't see as much fighting or as much, firm resistance as you do to something like the Ex-Im Bank.
Mm.
And honestly, I think for the base now, and the reason why you see this big rebellion is because they haven't fought for the things which really matter.
Yeah. No, I think that's great. I think some of that comes from the fact that there really is huge divides within the Republican Party on some of those social issues. I know we hear all the time that if we just would ignore the social issues, we could do much better, which is, A, like you said, crazy, because most people, the social issues are what affect their daily lives, healthcare, education, immigration. These are things that touch them. They, you know, the national debt, while that's bad, doesn't kind of touch them every day. Yeah. You know, you're exactly right. But those are where some of the greatest divides are in the party. As a result, you don't always get, you know, good coordinated action. And for some reason, this is something, frankly, for years I've been trying to figure out. And if anyone in the room has an answer, I would love to hear it. But why, you know, the Republican Party, and frankly, even some conservatives, are so passionately against X, Y, and Z. But then when it comes when there's an opportunity to defund X, Y, or Z, they don't do it.
Yeah.
That, you know what I mean? That's what I can't figure out. In other words, we as a party controlling Congress, we have funded every single signature initiative of the left that you can think of. In fact, that would be a great challenge. Think of some big liberal cause that we have defunded in the Republican Congress. Planned Parenthood? Nope, we're funding it. Executive amnesty? Illegal executive amnesty? Nope, no, we're funding that. Oh, Obamacare? Nope. Every nickel that Obamacare needs for implementation, we're giving it to him. Why is that? And you may say, well, come on, we don't have a filibuster-proof majority in the Senate. We have a Democrat in the White House. Fine, but a lot of times we won't even start the fight. You know, we won't even present a bill that does defund those things. We just immediately say, I give up, let's just fund it. And that's a shame. And that's something that I think we as conservatives, and certainly Ted Cruz, we're pushing against that thinking that let's at least give it a shot, let's at least fight. It's what the left does. And you can't win any fight you don't start. So let's go for it, let's push. So
thanks.
Cool. No, thank you.
Hey there, sir. Loyal Carpenter from College of the Ozarks. You talked a little bit about inequality in media reporting and a lot of the senators trying to pass things along. Do you recommend any media outlets or sources that are reporting on these issues, and how can we get access to those?
No, absolutely. You know what's been really great? I don't know if, how familiar you are with it, but Conservative Review, great publication. And they have some affiliates, Conservative Review TV, Mark Levin, obviously. We just more and more rely on them because they are putting out some of the truth of what's really going on. They're also pulling back the curtain behind the wizard, if you will, and they're really doing a great job. So I would stick with them. They're kind of our go-to source, and there's other great ones too. But you know, that's since you asked, that's some free advertising for them. I would definitely give them a shot. And you know, they've got a radio show, TV, print, just fantastic folks. So stick with Conservative Review. They're going far. They're going places. So
thanks.
Cool. Yeah, thank you. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Kelly from Minnesota, and I just really appreciate you coming to speak to us. I've really enjoyed it. I'm just wondering, I have a friend, we have a family friend who's running for Senate for Minnesota, and his district is liberal, and he's running with the knowledge that it's really liberal and not necessarily a positive outlook on how the election is going to turn out. And I'm just wondering if you have any advice or encouragement that you would give to someone like that.
Yeah, no, I mean, I know you'd be shocked by this advice, but stick to your principles and advance them in a very clear, meaningful way that connects with human beings. And the reason I say that is because what the left doesn't do is they don't shy off of their principles when they're in a conservative area. I don't know if you've noticed that. They just go forward and they try to connect with human beings and make their ideas sound reasonable to, you know, the average person. And I think we can do that. And frankly, it's what Ronald Reagan did. I always come back to him. I know this is significantly before your time, but you know what? Pull up some YouTube videos of some of his speeches. He was saying really principled, hardcore, movement, conservative type things, but wasn't saying it in a way that turned off folks on the left, folks in the middle. He made it was inclusive. He spoke to problems of human beings that we were talking about before, day-to-day lives, spoke to their fears, hopes, desires, and dreams, without pandering though either. You know, he didn't just say what people wanted to hear. So. Yeah, what I found, and this is even putting on my political science hat as well, is that a lot of voters are actually inspired just by people who believe in things strongly and articulate them well. That someone who kind of is wavering, I don't know, I sort of believe this, I'm a little bit over here, I'm kind of that, that doesn't inspire them. Even folks who are ideologically in the middle are more likely to be pulled to one side of the fence by folks who articulate a clear human-based, you know, vision, principle-driven action. So I know that's a simplified answer, but yeah, I would just encourage you to, you know, just push forward, stay strong.
Thank you.
Definitely. And I see, by the way, my there's a little clock here that is winding down, so I guess I should wrap it up. Let me just quickly give you my email address. It's just my Senate email address, nothing secretive about it. It's, you know, publicly listed, whatever. Let me just give it to you. It's Paul_Teller, so Paul_Teller, at cruz.senate.gov, C-R-U-Z, cruz.senate.gov. I'll try to be as responsive as I can. Obviously, if you all email me at once, that's going to be harder. But, you know, if you do have questions, even just especially the folks who ask questions, follow up on your specific points, or maybe you didn't want to ask a question, didn't want to bring it up publicly, but wanted to, you know, get some advice behind the scenes, happy to help. And thanks for being here. It's a real honor, and I look forward to staying in close touch with Young America's Foundation going forward. Thanks again.
All right, let's give Dr. Tell another round of applause.